For the final event of the day, we have our interactive session, the Palmocrit Quiz. To conduct this quiz session, I cordially invite Dr. Sachini Senaviratna, Consultant Pulmonologist at the District General Hospital, Vavuniya. Madam, the stage is yours.
Thank you very much. We would have loved to give an air ticket to Singapore, but you'd have to make do with this very, very valuable gift. All right. So I know we have many online participants, but we'll have to limit this quiz to the on-site participants. And I'm sorry, all the speakers are automatically disqualified from participating. Right. So, okay. So in the interest of time, we'll move on. So to participate in this, you'll have to take out a smart device, a tab or a phone. Okay, we can just check how alert you have been throughout the last few hours. Right. Okay, so while you're logging in, I'll just tell you how this works. So we have a few multiple choice questions. So the best of four or best of five needs to be selected. And the scoring depends on the accuracy and also how quickly you respond. Okay, so so very rarely there'll be two winners. It's almost always only one winner because it very accurately times how quickly you respond. Okay, so your brain and your fingers have to be working fast. So all these people who are logging in very late, I can already see that you have a very poor prognosis in this quiz. So hurry up. Right. So each question would either have 1 minute or 1.5 minutes, which includes the time for you to read the question. So I would try to read some of these questions really quickly. It'll also appear on your device. And because this platform has a limit to the number of characters, I've abbreviated some of the stems. But as doctors, we are masters of abbreviations. I'm sure you'll just breeze through it, so no problem. Okay, right, so let's start. Okay, 65-year-old previously healthy male presents with fever, cough, and difficulty in breathing for 5 days. On examination, he's slightly dyspneic with a respiratory rate of 18, pulse rate 90, blood pressure 110 over 70, saturation 94 on room air. Chest x-ray reveals left lower zone consolidation, inflammatory markers raised. What is the most appropriate antibiotic therapy for this patient? So we have 5 options, Piptaz and linezolid, ampicillin and levo, meropenem and vancomycin, ceftriaxone and clarithromycin, cefepime and clindamycin. You have 23 seconds more. Easy question. So the answers are coming in. 40 answers so far. Last few seconds. So we've been generous. All those late logins can give the answer. So okay. Right. Good. So 31 participants have given the correct answer. Quite a scattered number of wrong responses. So this is a fairly straightforward community-acquired pneumonia, and there's no reason to suspect either Staph or Pseudomonas. So a general cover is with the macrolide is sufficient. So ceftriaxone and clarithromycin. So it need not be IV, it can be oral. But for the uniformity of responses, we've given it as IV clarithromycin. Okay, next question. Oh, leaderboard. Maheshika, you're in the lead. Okay, followed closely by Pabasara and Kirushant. Okay. Next question. Right, question 2. 21-year-old girl admitted with fever, anodynophagia for 3 days, followed by neck pain. X-ray showed bilateral cavitating nodules. On ultrasound, there was an internal jugular vein thrombus. What is the most likely causative organism? Nontuberculous mycobacteria, Fusobacterium necrophorum, Mycoplasma pneumoniae, Legionella pneumophila, Mycobacterium tuberculosis. The answers are rolling in a bit slower. The disease itself has poor prognosis. Okay. Okay, so only 15 people have given the correct answer. So this is Lemierre's disease. I don't know if you, I'm sure there have enough postgraduate trainees in the audience, caused by Fusobacterium necrophorum, characterized by pneumonia and thrombosis of the major veins, can also give rise to effusions, and has to be identified early to save the patient. Right, next question. So, who's in the, HS APA has come to the lead. So Maheshika has been completely swept away, followed closely by Lakita. And then there's Pabasara. Was she there before? I think she was. So she's still in the game, right? Okay. Next question. Which of the following is the most likely route for bacteria to enter the lower respiratory tract in patients with ventilator-associated pneumonia? One, inhalation of airborne bacteria. Two, aspiration of oropharyngeal secretions. Transthoracic spread from contiguous structures. Direct hematogenous spread from another infection site. Ingestion of contaminated food or water. Again, easy question. Okay, right, so good. Majority of you have got the correct answer, which is aspiration of oropharyngeal secretions. So let's see who's in the lead now. Is it still APA? No, Lakita has come to the lead. Again, I don't know where APA is now. It's completely gone. Okay, right. Next question. Which of the following patients is most likely to have VAP or ventilator-associated pneumonia? Intubated patient with increased endotracheal secretions and new chest X-ray shadows on day 5 of intubation. ICU patient with 5-day-old central venous catheter developing fever at 36 hours after intubation. An ICU patient developing fever on day 1 of intubation. An ICU patient on high flow nasal oxygen developing new onset of fever and dyspnea on day 2 of ICU stay. Because the stems are slightly longer, we've given more time for this, so you can carefully go through the answers. So for anyone who doesn't understand, in the first response that says increased endotracheal tube secretions. Most of you have given the answer. We don't deduct points for wrong answers, so you can just give a blind guess if you don't know. Brilliant. Okay, 35 of you have given the correct answer. Right, let's have a look at the leaderboard. Lakita still in the lead, followed closely by Kalpani and then by Ayesha. Okay, and before we move on to the next question, on your own devices, you can zoom in on the question for better visibility if the font is too small. Right. So we have a personal achievement for Pereira, who has climbed up 9 places. Congratulations. Okay. Right. Next question. Which one of the following interventions is least likely to prevent ventilator-associated pneumonia? regular use of stress ulcer prophylaxis in all intubated patients, good oral care with 0.2% chlorhexidine twice daily, maintain ETT cuff pressure between 20 to 30 centimeters water, maintain the head of the bed at 30 to 45 degree angle, daily sedation holds, and access readiness to extubate. Okay, so you have a whole minute to answer, enough time, but remember you are marked on your speed. Seven of you are still weighing in on whether you're going to answer or not. I think almost all of you have answered. Again, we have 21 people giving the correct answer. Right. So let's have a look at the leaderboard. Lakita, still in the lead. Very good. Excellent. Followed closely by Kalpani and then Heeji. Okay. Next question. Which of the following radiological features strongly favor the diagnosis of HAP over alternative diagnosis? Lobar consolidation in the right upper lobe on chest x-ray, bilateral blunting of costophrenic angle with meniscus sign in the x-ray, airspace opacities of ground glass density in back wing distribution on chest x-ray, bilateral pathological B-lines with basal apical gradient in lung ultrasound. Okay, 2 seconds to go. Right. Again, 15 of you have got the correct answer. And okay, we have a new winner. Heeji is in the lead. So, Lakita, you've been dropped down, followed by Kalpani. Right. So, 6 more questions to go. So, I'm sure you can take up the lead again. Question number 7. Long-term NIV in chronic hypercapnic COPD is only indicated following acute exacerbations, is not suggested by the ERS task force, should be primarily administered by target volume ventilation, improves survival at a cost of reduced quality of life, should be titrated to normalize PaCO2. You have 27 seconds more. You guys falling asleep or something? The answers are coming very slowly. Is it because it was the last symposium? Right. Okay. Only 10 people have answered right. Okay, you guys have definitely been sleeping. Right. Okay, so most of you thought it improved survival at a cost of reduced quality of life. So, no, it doesn't reduce the quality of life. It keeps the patient out of the hospital, reduces exacerbations, and improves survival. Okay, right. Heeji is still at the lead, followed by Chaturi and Yashoda. So where's our previous winner? Was it Lakita? Yeah, still there, somewhere there. You still have hope. Okay. All right. Next question. Okay, you'll have to read quickly. 78-year-old COPD patient has admitted with a 2-day history of fever and shortness of breath. On arrival to ETU, he is confused, has a respiratory rate of 30, on-air saturation is 80, he has crepitations and bronchi on both sides. His blood gas after 1 hour of optimal medical management was a pH of 7.25, PO2 50, PCO2 60, bicarb 30. What is the best treatment modality for him? Prepare for intubation, paralysis and ventilation to control CO2. High flow nasal oxygen at a flow rate of 60 and titrate oxygen to achieve a saturation of 88 to 92. Titrate oxygen via venturi mask to achieve a saturation of 88 to 92. Nebulization with salbutamol and ipratropium. Start NIV at IPAP of 8 and EPAP of 5. I think if you had learned this from the last symposium, we would have been. Okay, I hope the performance is better in this one. Okay, 10 seconds to go. Right. Okay. Oh, good. So I could hear the sigh of relief from Dilesha. So you guys are listening. Right. So 31 have given the correct answer of starting NIV with an IPAP of 8 and EPAP of 5. Let's see who's leading. Still Heeji. Okay. So Chaturi has made a comeback. Congratulations, Chaturi. So stay there. Okay. Right. Next question. 45-year-old patient has type 2 respiratory failure. Which one is not a contraindication for NIV? Upper GI bleed, facial trauma or deformity, immunosuppressed with respiratory failure, cardiorespiratory arrest, inability to protect airway or cooperate. So easy question. Even if you were sleeping in the last symposium, with common sense, I think you can answer this question. So yeah, 30 seconds to go. Answers are rolling in. Come on, last 3 or 2. Very good. Okay, so 32 of you have given the answer of immunosuppressed with respiratory failure. So all the others are actually fairly straightforward contraindications. If you have a cardiorespiratory arrest and there's no spontaneous effort, you cannot apply NIV. And there's no airway protection with NIV. So if the patient is unable to protect the airway, that is again a contraindication, as is upper GI bleeding and facial trauma or deformity. Right. So Heeji is still in the lead, followed by Chaturi. And we have a new number 3, Arosha. Oh, Arosha. Right. Question number 10. So we're coming to the end now. NIV is considered superior to high flow nasal oxygen in the following, except type 2 respiratory failure due to COPD, cardiogenic pulmonary edema, obstructive sleep apnea, COVID pneumonia with hypoxic respiratory failure, community acquired pneumonia. Again, a very easy question. So we had a hot debate on this topic, so I'm sure you would answer this question correctly. Thank you. my mistake. Well, I got it the other way around in my head. So the correct answer is community-acquired pneumonia, and 14 of you have got the correct answer. So, which is not that great. We are not all that happy, but we'll move on. Right. So, okay, Heejee is still in the lead, followed by Arosha and then by Chaturi. Okay. So, two more questions to go. Right. 52-year-old previously healthy farmer from Ampara presented with fever, cough and difficulty in breathing of 3 days duration during a rainy season. On examination, he looks ill. Respiratory rate 20, pulse rate 100, oxygen saturation 92 on room air. Chest x-ray reveals left lower zone consolidation, WBC 18,000, neutrophils 89%, CRP 146, random blood sugar 330. What is the most likely etiological agent? Is it E. coli, Streptococcus pneumoniae, Burkholderia pseudomallei, or community-acquired MRSA? So there are quite a few points that you have to gather from this question. Seconds to go. Brilliant. Okay, so again, Eastern Province, rainy season. So despite the acute presentation, melioidosis is something that we have to think about as a number one possibility. Very good. Right. Heejee is still in the lead. Okay, very good. Right, the final question. So, which has something to do with the symposium, but also mostly to do with how well you know medicine in general and how well you read history and how interested you are in medicine. Okay, let's see. Okay. Captain of the men of death was the phrase used by Sir William Oster to describe which disease? Is it influenza? Is it typhus? Is it tuberculosis? Is it cholera? Or is it pneumonia? So the father of bedside teaching was particularly not very fond of this disease, which is pneumonia. Very good. Okay, so 28 of you have got the answer right. Are you ready to see who's the winner of that big box? Okay, drum roll please. So third place is Yashoda, second place Chaturi, and first place, who could it be? Heejee. Congratulations. Okay.
Present the awards for the winners. It gives me immense pleasure to invite on stage Dr. Dilshan Priyankara, President of the College of Critical Care Specialists. And at the same time, I would also like to invite on stage Mr. Chintakabe Singha and Hema Mayadunna from Guest Gets Pharma. In third place, Yashoda. And in first place, please give a round of applause to Heejee. Thank you. sisters, could you please remain on stage? I would now like to invite the winners of the quiz competition and Dr. Sachini for a photograph on stage. I would also like to invite Dr. Niranjan Disanayake and Dr. Dilesha Vadasinghe for the photograph. I would like to invite all the winners on stage, all three winners please. To hand out the token of appreciation for our moderator, Dr. Sachini Seneviratna, who did a splendid job of conducting the quiz and managing to keep us entertained at the same time, I warmly invite Dr. Dilshan Priyankara on stage. Thank you, sir. Thank you and congratulations once again to all the winners of Palmo Crit Quiz 2024. With that, we have now reached the end of today's proceedings. To deliver the vote of thanks, may I invite Dr. Sachini Seneviratna, Joint Secretary of the Sri Lanka College of Pulmonologists, on stage.
Thank you so much. And there are quite a number of people who worked really hard to get this program up and running. For a few weeks really. So first and foremost, I would like to thank the presidents of the Sri Lanka College of Pulmonology, Dr. Niranjan Disanayake and Dr. Dilshan Priyankara of the Ceylon College of Critical Care Specialists, and also their councils for putting up this great symposium, which it was a resounding success, and we hope this would become an annual event thereafter. So I would also like to thank all the speakers who came from very different parts of the country, from Jaffna, from Batticaloa. There was a lot of commitment behind this, a lot of planning, and I would like to thank all of them. And I think it was a highly successful program. And a special thank you to Sonali and Muthuni from our college office, who have worked tirelessly out of hours to make this event a success. And also our audiovisual team, Nalina and his team, for their support. And our sponsors, Getz Pharma, particularly I would like to mention Mr. Samandi Sanayake, Mr. Rasika Lienage, Mr. Hema Mayadunna, Mr. Chintaka Besingha, Mr. Asanka Nanayakar, and Mr. Varuna Mulligoda, who have all worked tirelessly behind the scenes for many weeks to get this program up and running. Thank you so much. And this program would not have been a success without all of you, our on-site and online participants. Thank you so much for taking your time to come here and learn and discuss these valuable topics with us. Thank you so much. I wouldn't hold you back from your lunch any longer. Thank you so much for coming.